Oh, five. Can we start it, Sristi?
Yeah, sure.
Okay, so before that, you can give a quick brief about yourself and then you can start the session. Over to you.
Hello everyone. I'm Srishti. So I'm basically an architecture student. I'll be graduating this year. But apart from that, I'm also an artist, and I've been learning for almost 18 years now. I have done my diploma in painting from the university. But apart from that, I've also learned a lot of art styles out of my own interests, and I have been teaching to small groups of people and individuals based on their requests. So I don't really follow one particular medium. If you look at my work, then you'll find that there's different kinds of work that I do. It's not just one style. So in today's workshop, just a second. In today's workshop, I'm going to be looking at covering evolved across the past so many years. I'm also going to be sharing this different from the other kinds of art that we know, and we look at a more detailed introduction to these art forms. What are the traditional colors that are used? Where is it that these art forms are from, and things like that. Finally, we'll be having one tutorial where I've chosen one single subject and looked at it in two different styles, so we could probably even compare to see how both of them are different and what are the similarities. And finally, we'll be looking, I mean, I'll be opening out for any questions or queries that you have to ask. So that is the agenda in rough. So let's look at the history first. So, I mean, Indian art is something that we can date back to 3rd millennium BC, which means that's almost 5,000 years prior. Just a minute.
Srishti, some people are not able to hear you, so can you be a little bit louder?
Yeah.
Yeah, sure.
Are you able to hear me now, guys?
Yeah,
Am
you're
I
audible.
audible? So, like I said before, we'll first start by looking at the history of Indian art. So, Indian art basically dates back to almost 5,000 years ago, and it started out mainly as a means of communication because language wasn't something that had evolved already. But now it's come a really long way, and we've seen some really intricate work. We've also seen new kinds of expression that have become a part of modern art styles. So I think someone had sent in a question asking for a list of art styles from each state. So this definitely is not the entire list, because I mean each of these styles have sub-styles and categories in them. But as you can see clearly over here, I mean even to try to classify it, there's so many styles of art, most of which we're not even aware of. So let's look at how art has evolved. First, you had the rock paintings, the cave paintings, and if you look at these, they're very simple. They convey things as people saw them because that's how they were read and used for communication. Then you had your first settlements and civilizations that started coming about. So you have the introduction of more human figures. More things that are part of, say, a community in terms of how their daily life is. Then you had the different dynasties that came in, and religion and the culture that came along with that. So one major influence was the Buddhist religion, and you can see their motifs like your flowers and things like that slowly start coming into the art itself. The other thing that comes with the Buddhist influence is the kind of features that you can find in the human beings or Buddha himself, the eyes and things like that. Parallelly, you have the South Indian dynasties and their literature, and you'll find a lot of stories of battle, royal courts, animals, stories, legends, war being depicted not just in sculptures but also in paintings. So if you look at some of these paintings, so far in the North Indian influences or the art that we see above the Deccan, you'll find that the colors are also very light, fair people and things like that. But when you look at the South Indian dynasties and the literature and the kind of art that you find in South India, you'll find the colors becoming darker, features becoming different, the proportions becoming different and things like that. This is the same thing that you can find in the statues. These are proportions that have been perfected over so many years of trying new proportions and figuring out what is the right one. So maybe so many years later, the more recent ones would be your Mughals and the Persian influence that they brought with them. So over here, if you see, there's one major influence in which is the color blue. So till now, the color blue is something that you don't find very common in Indian art. It's only when the Mughals came in that they bring it along with their blue pottery and things like that. Then finally, during the British period, you had mediums like watercolor come in. And this is where the city and the architecture of buildings and streets and activity, all this becomes part of the painting. Because until now, if you see, you have war and stories and there's events that are being shown as art. But from now, it becomes more of daily life and things like that. And finally, after the British is when you have a sudden diversification of art. So you have Ravi Verma and his style of painting. Then you have M.F. Hussain Sir and a very abstract kind of painting. The reason I put the two of them together here is to see how in a lot of ways their subjects were very similar, but the way they were expressed is very, very different. Then you have S.H. Raja Sir, Jamini Roy. So one of them looked at one particular style of painting from Calcutta called the Kalighat style, whereas the other person was working just with shapes and colors and experimenting with that. You have Satish Gujral Sir. Again, over here, I think so far it's very important to note that most of Indian art has the human beings and the animals in the foreground in key focus. The landscape becomes a background or just an addition to complete the painting. It's not something that is the focus of the painting, unlike say Van Gogh or Monet or any of your European styles in that sense. Then this is Bose Krishnamachari Sir. Very, very abstract. Sometimes you won't even understand what he's trying to convey until and unless you read what he has actually tried to tell us about his paintings. And Tota Vaikuntham Sir. So here he's combined the colors and the richness of what we see, but at the same time he's maintained a very easy to read kind of style in terms of the painting itself. So through this, if you look at it, like I said before, the color palette is something that was, I won't say limited, because at the end of the day, even today as artists, all of us mix colors and only come up with new colors. But at that point of time, the major palette was red, yellow, green, black, and white. And in most cases, the white was also the blank space that was left and not something that was added on later. So that is something that's very important for us to note. And this is kind of a larger range of colors that you can figure out based on the same four colors that were predominantly used. So now I'm going to talk to you more about the folk art style. So till now we have seen very historical mainstream kinds of folk art, which spoke only about a certain section of society, like your kings, the rulers, and people like that. It very rarely spoke about your normal day-to-day life, which is where folk art comes into the picture, because most of your folk art styles are the ones where we learn about how people used to live or things like that. So there are a lot of folk arts that are more common, like your Kalamkari and maybe even your Kerala murals. But I've picked certain arts that not many people know about. So the first one is your Kalamaruthu from Kerala. This is similar. It's a style of drawing a kolam, but this is done only for rituals. And as soon as the ritual is over, the art is also washed away or rubbed away. Then you have your Rajasthani miniature painting. Here you will find scenes from the royal court or of women and things like that, which are not depicted in other mainstream forms of art. So over here you have the introduction of materials like gold and pure silver and precious stones that start getting added on, and they are also used as part of the art. So there's a three-dimensional effect that comes in. Buildings are shown more clearly, things like that. Then you have your Tanjavur painting. Now, the reason I've specified early Tanjavur painting here is all of us have seen Tanjavur paintings being sold today in galleries in so many places, but Tanjavur painting as we know it today is not how it originated. And most of these Tanjavur paintings were considered to be very sacred. So they were never signed by the original artists, and you can find them mostly only in temples. So this is where blue color starts coming slowly into the picture in South India. Until then, you can't see blue. You'll only see red, a dark green, browns and colors like that. So if you look at some of these paintings, especially these two on the right, this is something that has been taken at Brihadeeshwara temple. Now, we know Brihadeeshwara temple as a temple where Shiva is worshipped, but there's almost one whole wall where you have the story of Krishna and Lord Vishnu, and these are the things that are part of the murals, and some of them aren't really maintained very well, but this is the style that you can see. And you can slowly see the introduction of stones, some amount of embossing, gold foil work. And this is the style that we have sort of taken forward now today when we talk about Tanjavur painting. Next you have, this is the Pattachitra. So Pattachitra is a style of painting that comes from Orissa. And it's very detailed, as you can see. So this panel over here is almost 6 feet by eight and a half feet. That's how huge that is, bigger than a bed. And it's extremely detailed work. One panel like this takes one artist almost a month or a month and a half to finish entirely, because till today, the people who make Pattachitra paintings don't use paint brushes, don't use artificial or paints as their pigments. They still go back to the original way of taking the gum of the tree as a base and then adding natural pigments for it. So the process is very, very elaborate. In fact, even the cloth that they prepare is pieces of cloth that they gum together and then they allow it to dry. So it's a very elaborate process, very intricate process. And over here, again, like, you don't have any normal human life that's depicted. It's only depiction of the Jagannath Puri temple, Krishna Leela, the Dashavatar of Vishnu. These are the subjects that are used or depicted in Pattachitra paintings. Then you have the Kalighat style. So the Kalighat style, one reason why this is different from the other folk art that we have seen so far is that this was the first one that could be reproduced by the process of printing. So these outlines were drawn, copies were made using lithography or printing techniques, and then the prints were hand-colored. So while initially it started off with Kali and around the temple being the subject, later on it started showing human emotions in like normal day-to-day life. During the independence struggle, you had freedom fighters and their stories being depicted in Kalighat paintings. So this is how this evolved. And this evolved also pretty late compared to the others, around 19th century, which means that's your 1800s in West Bengal. Then you have the Chitra style. So if you are someone who already knows what Varli painting is, then the Chitra style seems very similar. But your key difference here is that Varli painting still talks about daily life, whereas Chitra style restricts itself only to weddings, wedding halls, chariot processions and things like that. And this started in northern Karnataka and has and slowly like got spread across the entire of Karnataka. And this is again made using one or two colors. So you have yellow, red, brown and black. These are the four colors that are used. And between combinations of this two or a maximum of three colors is all that you see being used. And this originated from a tribal group in the Western Ghats. So that is the Chitra style. Then you have Gondad. So Gondad stands out very differently from other folk art again because of the colors that are used and also the introduction of patterns. So till now you've either seen a very minimalistic kind of style like in the Chitra style or in styles like the Tanjavur paintings or even the Kalighat paintings, there's a very clear shading and to make it more realistic. Whereas in this Gondad, if you see, you see the application of flat colors with patterns on top of them. And most of these are inspired from nature, of course, but also from their dreams of how they would want their daily lives to be or what it would be like if, say, Krishna came and lived with them as a person. So this is the kind of art that Gondad shows. And even today, when you see modern interpretations of Gondad, it still talks about dreams and fantasies and things that may not really exist in the true world. So this is like a recent interpretation of it where it looks like there's a demon and there's a monkey conversing and things like that. So for the tutorial today, I've actually chosen two particular styles. I've chosen the Madhubani style, which is also called the Mithila style. And I've chosen the Varli style from Maharashtra. So I'm going to be talking about these art styles by showing you examples of both. So it's easy to compare and understand. So the Mithila region is somewhere around present-day Bihar. And the reason it's very different is because of the style of drawing. It's two-dimensional. You have double lines. So the people of this tribe believed in the dualism or how, people who know the concept of Vartanarishwar, they always look at duality that exists in life. So they always use a set of two lines while drawing. It's not one line. And this is something that's common throughout. So, one second, my screen is... So in terms of their subjects, they don't restrict themselves to certain kinds of subjects. You see a lot of different subjects, whether it's nature or Krishna or a wedding procession. So it's a very varied kind of subjects that are portrayed. And again, just like the Gondad, you'll find a lot of patterns being introduced over here, very vibrant colors. So, in fact, these are colors that probably, or patterns also for that matter, that probably don't exist in nature. Like, how many times would you find a fish with this kind of a pattern on its body? So, and like Madhubani style evolved as something that a girl would learn and later on gift it to the family that she gets married into and things like that. So this is like a very detailed Madhubani art where it's showing a wedding procession. So you can see how very distinct it is. It's very heavy to the eye, basically. It's not something that's very minimal and clean that you can just see and appreciate. You have to really concentrate and look at it before you understand what it is. I muted myself by mistake, sorry. So like I was saying, that is Madhubani, and Varli is the exact contrast of that, where it's very simple shapes and very easy to understand. So essentially you're using a circle, a triangle and a square, which and lines, which means anyone can draw this. It's not something that's very difficult. And these paintings, they talk about not just stories of how people lived, but also what are the difficulties that they went through, or how far their source of water was and things like that. So when you really understand and read these paintings, you'll not just learn about, oh, this is how they used to live, but much more than that. And traditionally, this is done in white over a brown background, which is most common. But now you can find it being done in all colors, on fabric, on walls, on phone cases, bed sheets, anything. So Varli painting has become that popular. And it's also very easy to reproduce, whether it is in terms of blocks or printing or any kind of technique. So like I said, you could have something as simple as, say, three women going to work and it's raining and they're showing birds flying in the sky. Then this is a slightly more advanced level, where it talks about the men and women dancing on a festival day. And then this is a new level of complexity, where it talks about you have the river, you have the fields, you have people working in the fields. Then it's raining, which is shown by the clouds and the rain and the sun. And then there's also women working inside the house. So like, it becomes that much more detailed. You can even find fish in the river. So that's how detailed these paintings can be. This again is one entire wall done by one person. And this is again not done using any brushes. They use bamboo sticks that are dipped in a rice paste to sit and color. So this one wall is around 7 feet by 3 feet. And this takes almost 2 months to complete by one person. Like I said, you have the bullock carts, you have the houses, you have a road, the river. So so many layers of complexity is added. So now let's get to the tutorial, where you could probably draw along if you wish to, or have a look and then we can discuss later.
Srishti, we have a question here. So
yeah.
So are all these styles inspired from some specific tribes? They're asking as if like, are they practiced by some minorities in India or something like that? Or like, most of these arts are coming from some kind of tribes. Is it so? That's what they're asking.
So folk art is something that comes mostly from a group of tribes. And people who've learned from them are the ones who practice it separately right now. Mm-hmm. But still, so a lot of people know Varli painting and have seen it. Similarly, Kalamkari now, especially in fashion, it's really picked up. So people are aware of it. But so many of these other styles are something that people don't even know about, because it's practiced only by these minor communities in the country. It's not something that everyone knows about.
Okay.
So that is that. Cool. Can we move on to the tutorial and then continue, or?
1 second. There's another question. So is there a color restriction to do Madhubani? Do we use only specific colors in?
So Madhubani is a little more free than any of these other. Traditionally itself, it's more free than any of the other art styles, because it uses all colors in all combinations. So. Now, if you would want to make a Madhubani painting, you can use pretty much all colors. I think your only restrictions would be things like your neon colors and colors that are very new and recent. But again, if you would want to make a modern interpretation of it, you could go ahead and use those as well. Traditionally, if you would want to know, then there is no color restriction. There's light colors, dark colors of all shades that are used in a Madhubani painting.
Okay. So was painting a profession? So that's the next question.
Yeah, so painting was not a full-time profession for anyone at that point of time, except in the case of certain styles like your Rajasthani miniature paintings and your Tanjavur paintings, where these craftsmen were commissioned by the rulers at that point of time to do it, say, on a temple wall or as a gift or as a panel for a new construction in a palace or a fort. So apart from these specific groups of people who were commissioned to do this work, painting was not a profession. So most of the folk art that you see was something that was more like a something that they did in their leisure time. So like, I think while talking about Madhubani, I had mentioned how Madhubani paintings were made by the girls in the house to later on gift to their husband or the family that they get married into. Similarly, Varli painting was, there would be this one wall in the village or on their house that people would slowly keep adding layers to. So what we sit and complete in, say, 1 month or 1.5 months or 1 week, depending on what kind of painting we're doing right now, sometimes used to take 5 years or 6 years. Maybe some of these paintings, they depict these festivals and festival dances, right? So some of them could have been continued only once a year when the festival came. So none of these paintings really came up in 1 day or 2 days because everyone had some other work to do.
Okay, so painting was not basically a profession, but they did it as a leisure or some kind of a gifting purpose.
Yes.
Okay, cool. So I guess like we are done for some questions now. We can proceed to the tutorial video now.
Yeah. So this tutorial is a Varli painting, basically. One second. So over here, I've chosen the Varli style because it's the easiest out of the lot to learn in a short duration. And I'm going to be showing how to paint a peacock with its feathers open. So all art styles show peacocks both with their feathers closed as well as in full flare when they're dancing. So this particular tutorial is in Varli style and it shows a peacock when it's dancing. So I first created a basic pencil outline over here for the exact proportions of the body and the head. But I'm going to be painting over this. And while usually, I mean, traditionally it's done on a brown background with white paint on top, I've chosen the exact opposite combination over here to be able to show it more clearly. So over here, what I've been doing is I'm taking the center of the body and I'm drawing a symmetrical shape of a shade or a heart. So the first line is more to give me an idea of how much I can go in to draw the feathers, whereas the outer line is my final line. Then I'm drawing these circular figures for each of my feathers. So I'm going to be drawing the feathers in each of these circles later on. And I'm going to be doing this entire process using a paintbrush, but it's something that you can choose to first go with a pencil and then draw on it if you're doing it for the first time or you're not confident about your brush skills yet. So the lines that I'm marking is the start to the feather. So when you see a peacock feather, you have the center that is green, and then you have the first set of colors around it, and then you have the final feather that goes out from that center point. So those lines are to mark my centers, basically. So now that I've drawn this basic outline, I'm going to start detailing it out. So I'm not going to be drawing every single feather. I've just drawn one to show you how it is that the feather comes out. So I've drawn the center circle, and then I'm going to be drawing the feather throughout. So I'm choosing one color, which is the brown. It's a reddish brown, burnt sienna if you're using a tube color basically. And I'm going to first start with the central body of the peacock itself, and then move on to the feathers. So the other thing in varli painting is that
chal ab varli painting kare jo uss tarah varli painting.
So the other thing with varli painting is that there is not much detailing that's done inside these silhouettes, so it becomes easy to paint. You don't have to detail out every single eye and all of that.
Hello all, wo kaun log honge jinko ye current pandemic jo situation hai hamare duniya pe ab wo affect nahi karegi virus
affect. I'm going to pause the video to mute.
Ye baat aap sab jante hain ki किसी को यूनिवर्स लॉज ऑफ एनर्जी के हिसाब से
yeah, sorry about that. I'm sharing. So I'm first coloring the body of the peacock. I'm gonna leave this part for now because I'll be drawing it separately, so there's a gap and a distinction between the main body and that part. So these are the kind of lines which require a lot of practice for you to be able to do it directly on a brush. So if you are just starting out, then you could feel free to even try like varli painting, like the whole peacock itself, using say a thick marker or a pen or something like that, and then once you're feeling confident enough, migrate to a brush. But I would still suggest that you start using a brush directly, because the more lines you draw is when you will start knowing where you have to improve, or you will improve in fact. So yeah, so I'm going to be patterning it out a little over here, just to create some kind of difference. Otherwise this one part of the painting becomes more heavy with like an entire fill. So I'm using finer lines over here to sort of fill this entire portion. So when I first learned how to do varli painting, I did not learn it using a brush. I was given a bamboo toothpick to sit and draw lines with, and sometimes the paint would get too watery, sometimes the paint would be too thick, so the line wouldn't come for more than a centimeter. So it took a really long time before the lines used to come properly, or at least for a decent amount of time using the stick. Again, with this tail, I'm leaving that slight difference in the way I'm filling it, so that it doesn't look very heavy and dark compared to the rest of the peacock. So there's no rule that you have to start at the top of the paper and then come to the bottom. It's more about what you're comfortable with. and also the kind of paint that you use. If you were, say, using something that takes a lot of time to dry, then you will have to keep that in mind and start from the feathers and then finally complete the body of the peacock. But it depends on what colors you use. Over here, I've used a mix of poster colors and watercolors so that it dries quickly, but it's still very easy to work with. So I'm drawing a double line over here. I'm going to be starting with that one feather that I'd already drawn the pencil on, and then I'll be doing the rest of the feathers. So if you can see, I've switched to the thinner brush because this requires finer strokes. The other flexibility of directly working with a brush is that sometimes when you draw with a pencil and then draw with a brush over it, it restricts the kind of strokes that you will make with your brush. You'll end up following the pencil lines exactly. And if you've drawn with the pencil perfectly, then that's a different thing. But if you haven't, then you'll be restricting yourself to just those lines. So I think now you can, now you will realize why it is that I've drawn these circles. So they give me a better idea of how big the feather should be so that I don't get confused while filling it up. So if you see over here, I've actually not followed that pencil line because the way the feather is drawn, I felt like it needs a little more overlap. So I introduced one more feather along that outer edge. So I'm going to fast forward this a little. Okay, I'll fast forward it like this. So if you can see, I've just continued the same style of drawing feathers throughout, keeping that slight overlap, but not really overlapping them. So when you look at one half of it, this is probably how it will look like. If you are doing this with a paintbrush, then I suggest you use, say, 00 or a 000 brush to do this, and try out strokes separately before you start painting on this. So this is one half. Then I'm doing the center first before I continue with the left side. Just forward it a little so you can see the rest of it. The other beauty of like any folk art style in particular is that your lines don't have to be perfect. I think a lot of times when we are creating any art for that matter, we have this inner perfectionist that comes out where things have to be perfect. Every line has to come out perfectly. It's not a wrong thing to have, but especially when you're exploring a new art style for the first time, don't allow that to determine whether or not your painting has come out right, whether this is the way to do it, because it takes a lot of practice before you get to the point where, you know, you can think of, no, everything has to be perfect. What if, I mean, I can't make mistakes. All of us learn by making mistakes, and that's something that's very important that we should definitely keep in mind. I'm going to fast forward it a little more. So if you see now, the feathers are all complete. It's just the last one that I'm completing over there. But the painting doesn't necessarily have to end over here. So you could add, say, a tree next to it. Or you could even add a second layer of feathers, or not to the same extent, but maybe just a tiny part, or maybe even dots to the outer of every feather to make it look more elaborate. I think that's what I'm going to be doing over here, where I've used dots on every alternating feather to sort of complete the whole painting. So again, these are not dots that I'm keeping for every single edge, because in a lot of cases, I won't even know which is the exact edge. So I'm just tracing that entire line of the circle with dots to sort of look, to make it look like it's coming from each of these feather points. So if you can see, I've chosen every alternating feather except for the center over here, where there's a overlap of sorts. And this part of the video is in double speed. I don't paint this fast. It's just to add one more layer of detailing to the painting. So yeah, that is the tutorial. This is a Varli peacock. I'm just going to show you a picture of the final presentation. I mean, the final picture that we painted. So that on the left is the Varli peacock tutorial that I had just shown. And the one on the right is the Madhubani peacock. So some of these differences are pretty obvious. You'll find that this is slightly more close to what a peacock looks like in reality than say this. These are the kind of shapes that we don't really see. And over here, what this person, I mean, the folk tribals who started this form of painting, what they have seen in the structure of a peacock feather is not what the same people have seen in the people who've done the Madhubani painting. And over here, you can see the double lines that are there. You can see the colors that come in. And you can see the introduction of new motifs into these motifs, like these waves, these flowers. These are things that are not seen in the peacock in reality. And even in terms of the colors, I mean, look at the colors. You have purples, you have greens, you have a very different palette that comes into the picture. So that is that. I'm just going to leave this here if anyone wants to take a screenshot. Thank you, guys. I saw comments in the chat that say that they're very pretty. Thank you very much. So before I open myself for any questions that all of you have to ask, I'm going to show you a work of 5 artists who are taking forward folk art in India. Again, like I said before, some of these art styles aren't known to anyone. So you'll find that the references that I've shared with you are for very common arts. So first you have the Varli style, where this person is still going back to the traditional way of drawing it. No new interpretations. It's exactly the way it was done before. Then you have the Madhubani painting style. These are the kind of colors that are traditional pigments. These are not acrylic paints. These are not mixed, new age colors. These are all colors that are part of the traditional palette. Then the Kalighat painting style, where now it's being adapted to non-printable versions. So if you see over here, the black outlines are missing. They're no longer there. They're more realistic, shaded. They talk about normal everyday life, not about just the goddess or freedom fighters or important people. Then, like I'd said before, the Gond art. So this is part of a set of illustrations and tapestry, embroidery that's being done for children's play schools, nurseries, and even like books for that matter. So yeah, I'm open to question and answers now. I think you can feel free to unmute and ask me them directly instead of...
Yeah, sure. So Aishwarya and Lakshmi Supriya have already asked. So Aishwarya, you can unmute and ask it yourself.
Yeah. Hi. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
So, okay. Yeah. I had asked you in the chat whether if there is any specific design to follow on the Madhubani art style, because most of the designs, like, is it okay if we use random designs or do we follow specific designs, excepting the two line double line form? Do we have any specific designs which we implement on any subject, whichever we do it on Madhubani?
Yeah, so I'm just going to go back to the presentation to show you one of these Madhubani paintings. So if you see Madhubani painting, basically, one second. So it's not like you have a set, say a dictionary or a cheat sheet that says these are the style, these are the shapes. But if you do look at the paintings, you'll find that you have three common things that are there. You have these kind of dots and concentric circles. You'll find lines that are being used to shade, parallel lines. And in terms of the flowers and the leaves, you'll only find one style, which is your rounded, simple, semicircular round. And similarly, the simple flower, there's no pointed flowers or any elaborate curved or shaped petals or anything. This is it. And even in the leaves, if you see, this is the shape of the leaf. Some of them have the lines drawn in them, some of them don't. But these are the shapes that are used. You don't see other shapes at any scale. So even in this, if you see the shape of the leaf is the same. It's just a simple leaf that we're taught to draw. Except say this, but this is a much more recent style. This is not a traditional Madhubani leaf.
Ah, okay. 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 And do we often use pen? Because whatever you showed, the tutorial, it was completely used with brush, right? So yeah. can we use, the micro tip pens to make minute designs on Madhubani, or that is basically, it changes the whole style? Is it
So if you're starting out and you're interested in learning, then I would say you could use a pen mm-hmm. or a fine liner, but mm-hmm. Traditionally it's not used. So if you really want to go the traditional way and learn it, then I would suggest you start practicing using a brush. But mm-hmm. otherwise, I think unlike a mandala where we use different thicknesses of pens, say a 0.3 sometimes, a 0.5 yeah. sometimes, maybe you should yeah. restrict to say one thickness throughout. So it gives you that uniformity that you would get if you use one brush.
Okay. 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 Yeah. And so basically with the Varli art, they use most of the paint artworks are based with brown and white, right? So
yeah.
is there any reason for the brown color?
So the brown color basically comes from cow dung and red oxide. So cow dung has properties of being antiseptic, if I'm...
Antiseptic, yeah.
Yeah. So that was what was used to wipe the walls with the hands. It was a manual process, and in that whole process the wall also got colored. So either that or red soil. So if you see Varli painting, that comes from Maharashtra, and Maharashtra has reddish soil and blackish soil. So it's okay. the soil that's being used to create that base, which is why that color comes into the picture. And similarly, this is not a pigment, but it's a rice paste that's used to draw the Varli painting traditionally. So that's okay. why those colors.
Okay. Okay. Yeah. Okay, I am done with questions for now. Yeah, thank you. Also, they looked really good, the work you had done.
Thank you, Aishwarya.
Yeah.
Yeah, Lakshmi, go ahead.
Hi, Srishti.
Hello.
Hi, Srishti, can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you, Lakshmi. Go ahead.
Cool. So, first of all, thank you for putting up this brilliant session on art and its history and how... does folk art come about? Because I think it's high time we all come to know the importance and existence of folk art at the moment. And so thank you first for that.
Thank you very much.
So I've got a very small question, just one question, that's it. So you were talking about...
Go ahead.
You were talking about the kind of paints that you were using for doing the Varli painting, right? So you said you've been using
yeah.
watercolors and poster colors. So my question is,
yeah.
can the same painting be done in gouache or acrylic paints?
Yeah, you could see, today none of us are going to sit and work on a plastered wall with the rice paste. So I think that is something that all of us need to understand first. And in terms of ease, acrylics is still something that I would not suggest, unless say you're trying to paint it on a wall or a canvas where poster colors or watercolors are still difficult. Simply because acrylic colors, the consistency is not something that you can control throughout like you would with a gouache or a poster color. And if you are trying this out on paper, then gouache is the best medium to try this out with. It's creamy, it gives you that consistency that's very similar to a rice paste, and you can use you'll get the exact colors as well. In acrylic, it's not, you probably won't get the same color throughout also, because you're constantly adding water, making it so that whole process is there for the consistency to be maintained. So yeah.
So and now, like you said, you were saying, like We don't be having any kind of a plaster wall or a built surface or a solid surface to work on. So when you're talking about paper, what would be the type of paper that would work best on paintings like Madhubani and Varli?
So Madhubani, since you have a lot of background washes that are also made, I would suggest something that is, say, a minimum thickness of a Chitrapath painting block, that's I guess 180 to 200 GSM, or even a thicker watercolor sheet. So any of your watercolor paper would be good enough for a Madhubani painting or a Varli painting for that matter. Varli painting you could still do with a paper that's not as thick, say a normal sketchbook paper, because you don't really have the kind of wash that you would be doing on a background that you would in a Madhubani style painting.
Okay, so these were my doubts. So thank you so much for clarifying.
No mention. Any more questions?
Hi, Shrishti. I just want to ask you if you have some idea on cubism and that type of an art. If you do have, can you like conduct another workshop on that?
Yeah. So I've actually studied Van Gogh and Picasso and Rembrandt as well, very detailed, out of my own passion for it, to understand impressionism and cubism.
Okay.
So yeah, if there are more people interested, then sure. But I am no expert. I am also learning. That's a disclaimer that I'll put out there right now.
Okay. Yeah. So I was just curious to learn that type of art, cubism, which it was quite peculiar to me. So I just wanted to know if anybody knows it and I could like know more about it. Yeah.
Sure.
That's a good question, Aishwarya. So we'll also look out for someone who's actually into, because we have our own set of expert artists like Shrishti also. So we'll try to get someone who can actually do a session on cubism also. Just keep following us. You'll know about it. Okay.
I think on the topic of cubism, while registering for the workshop, someone had put out this question asking what the difference is between European art and Indian art. So like, since Aishwarya brought up that question of cubism, I think I'll answer that here now. So if you see European art, the way it started is very different from the way Indian art started. So you have one portion of it, which is still from your Greek civilization, which is the same sculptures and human figures. That's very similar to Indian art. But in terms of painting, you'll find that one part of it is purely where the landscape is given the importance, not the people, not the rulers, not the story. So that is one key difference. And also styles like abstract versions came about much later in Indian art than it did in the European style. So if you see European styles, you have Impressionism as an art movement that started about where you have just the colors, and again your subjects are purely landscape oriented. And then somewhere in the 1700s, 1800s, it shifts directly to something like the Sistine Chapel and Michelangelo's work and Rembrandt, where it's very detailed human figures that are being drawn. So the kind of transition that you see in Indian art is not something that's very apparent in European art. So yeah, that is the answer to that.
Yeah, thank you.
Okay, guys, do we have any more questions here? Because I'm just right now looking at the questions that came in the forms. Okay, I think mostly we've covered actually. Traditional and European. Okay, so I wanted to ask some questions. So there are a lot of people who are actually starting out art specifics. Okay, so what I would ask on behalf of those people is that, so what are the materials that they can use? Like very standard and easily available materials that you can suggest for people. What would that be?
So if you're looking at, one thing, like I said before, is that it's really important to invest in good watercolor paper, even if you don't invest in professional grade paints. In fact, I would suggest not to invest in professional grade paints when you're starting out. Camlin artist watercolors are extremely good, very easily available to start with. Even if you are looking at poster colors, you could go ahead with a brand like Camlin or Faber-Castell. That's definitely sufficient to start learning. But in terms of the paper, I would suggest that you look at either Chitrapat or Brustro watercolor papers. They're not very expensive. I think for a A5 pack of 20, it costs you around 150 rupees or 200 rupees. That's the range. So again, that is also pretty easily available. And this again, I say because the same watercolor paint that you use on a normal sketchbook paper will appear to be much more dull than it does on a watercolor paper, something that's certified as a watercolor paper. So that quality difference is definitely there. So do invest on the paper, but not necessarily on the paint when you're starting out. Later on, you could shift to professional grade paints if you choose to, depending on what kind of medium you want to take forward. And also in terms of brushes, I think synthetic Faber-Castell or Camlin brushes are a good start. They give you the kind of detailing that you want. You have round brushes, you have flat brushes, you have your detailed brushes. So yeah, that's a good set to start with.
Okay, we have a question. Do we get Chitrapat in regular store?
You do get it in a lot of stationery stores. If you don't get it in a stationery store, it's available on Amazon. Hindustan supplies it, so you could always get it from them. They have all stationery all the time. So
Awesome. That's great. Like, we got some really beautiful insights, and even like the historical stuff that we actually saw today. Like, you actually gave a transition from what those things happening during the Mughal Empire and what happened when the Britishers came. So all those things were like really interesting. And the really short video where you did a full sketch of what Peacock could actually look like, those are also like the most interesting parts. It was a really great session, actually. That's something that I wanted to tell you about on behalf of Kali. We have one last question, so we'll take we'll wind up the session with them.
Sure.
So also, if possible, I'm keen to learn hand lettering. So if a workshop is possible, hand lettering, okay, we'll take that into consideration. So we'll definitely you can keep following us. We'll definitely update you on that. Definitely. Yeah.
Yeah. So I'm just going to put out my Instagram over here if someone hasn't seen it already and they
definitely,
want to.
Definitely.
Just a minute. Okay. I'm not able to share my screen. So I'll just type it out.
You can just type it out here so that people can actually take it.
So I'm there on Instagram as Anchored Hughes, and like I said before, I do teach like different styles of art to people who are interested. And if any of you do try out the Peacock, please do share it with me. I would really like to see someone who's done it after watching this tutorial.
Definitely. I think tomorrow you'll be seeing some posts on your Instagram inbox, DM, and some people even might tag you also. I think that will be great because
definitely.
We've seen some
looking forward to today.
Of course. Yeah.
I'd like to thank Galerio for the opportunity. I mean, if it wasn't for you, I wouldn't have been able to do this. So thank you very much, both Raghu and Elan.
Yeah, it's been great pleasure hosting you today. Okay, guys, we'll keep you posted and we'll send you the slides of which happened today and the if possible, we'll send out the video also so that you can follow up on the same and keep learning, okay? So we'll keep you posted about the upcoming sessions also. You can keep following us and that's what we wanted to say about today. Okay, guys, it's been great hosting you. Thank you, Shristi. Thank you all the participants today. So I think we'll wind up this session, okay? You can catch up with Shristi on this given Instagram handle. Course.
Thank you, everyone.
Yeah.
Have
Thank you,
nice
guys.
Day.
It's been a great day. Yeah.